this morning and listened to the little kids sing, and then I heard the choir sing, and then I heard the ladies sing, and I couldn't help but shout, amen.
Amen.
Sometimes I go to churches and I shout, and they look at me like, what is he doing that shouting for in church? If you don't like shouting in church, you're going to be in trouble in eternity. Because in heaven, we're going to be shouting, praise the Lord.
Amen.
And if you don't have Jesus Christ in your heart, when you go to eternity in a place called hell, the flames, there will be shouting going out. People will be crying, gnashing their teeth. Constant noise that never goes away. Seeing but not seeing beyond your hand. So if you don't like my shouting, you better get right with God. Amen? And last that I want to show you, and then I'll get to the message. In Luke chapter 8, we read about the maniac of Gadara. He was healed of his devil possession, seeing in his right mind. What a miracle. Hey, the woman with the issue of blood, healed years and years and years of being sick, going to every doctor in the world, and all she did was touch the hem of the garment, and she was healed. Virtue left the Lord Jesus Christ to heal that lady. The household of Jairus' daughter was raised from the dead. So if you read the book of Luke, you see all the miracles that have taken place in the book of Luke. Now, I want to tell you a story about chapter 16. I read it up here earlier. The story of the rich man and the beggar Lazarus. This morning we read these verses and we quickly learned that the greatest gift and greatest treasure anyone can ever receive is the gift of salvation.
Amen.
Listen to me. I'm not a rich man. I would rather have the gift of salvation than all the money in the world.
Amen.
Because all the money in the world will be left on this earth. I don't have Jesus Christ in my heart. I don't get to go to heaven. And guess what? I don't even bring my money with me in heaven. I don't need it. Streets of gold. You know what that means? You know the little bitty rocks that are on the side of the road, little pebbles? In heaven, they're going to be chunks of gold. Amen? But we also learn that the greatest loss a person can have is the loss of his soul. If you have a knowledge of Jesus Christ, that you never bow your head and ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins, and by the way, this morning, look at me. Everybody in here, everybody in this room, everybody in this whole world, they are all sinners, according to the Bible. According to Scripture, we're all sinners. And the greatest loss is for someone to sit in a church service like this and hear the man of God stand up and preach his precious word and give an invitation, and you sit there and go, oh, not today. You better be careful. Tomorrow may be the last day you breathe on this earth. We don't know. We don't know when our day is going to be here. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? It doesn't matter your position, your place, where you are, how much money you have, how many cars you have. It doesn't matter. Without Jesus, those things profit me nothing. I have a four-door pickup truck. I have a big old 1500 motorcycle. I have another car for my wife. I have a doctor, a brain surgeon, friend of mine, gave me a Mercedes-Benz to drive. And they mean absolutely nothing when I take my last breath on this earth and I don't know Jesus Christ as my Savior.
Amen.
For what shall a man in profit? What shall, if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Our greatest losses in this life are not the things that we possess. But what you need to understand is that life is not made of what you possess. Life is made up what possesses you. What is it that is more important than God in your life? Whatever it is, it's not worthy of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not worthy at all. Jesus spoke twice as much of his time preaching and teaching on hell as he did heaven. So I know you may feel uncomfortable this morning about my subject, but my subject today is about hell. The certainty, listen, you say, well, I don't agree with you, right? The certainty of hell was clearly established by Christ.
Amen.
He wanted to warn you that you need to stay away. The Bible says that Jesus would have all of us to be saved. But the problem is, there are so many things in the world that draw, especially our young people's attention away. I'm a police officer in America, and the majority of most of the crimes that are committed by young people. Yes, I'm a part of a violent crime unit. Is that good? I'm a part of a group of men in a violent crime unit. And every week we get together and we tell each other about the different crimes taking place. We try to work together. FBI, CIA, ATF, all of us get together. City police, sheriff, state police. We get together every Wednesday. And we share information to help arrest these people. And I'm telling you, listen to me, the majority of our violent crimes are being committed by young people. And the reason why is because the public schools now, they don't teach, they indoctrinate. They don't teach reading, writing, and arithmetic. They teach that you can be a boy and act like a girl, or you can be a girl and act like a boy, or you can be a boy and act like a cat and go to school. They teach that in America now. It's crazy. It's not an education place anymore. At least in America, it's not. What I wanted you to see, the first thing I noticed, I'm going to keep an eye on my watch, brother. I won't go long. I got a lot of points. No, I'm joking. I don't know. Okay? But the first thing I want you to notice was the rich man in this story. Now, when we read about the rich man, we think, oh, he was not a good guy. But that's not true. I studied this Word of God, he's not depicted or shown as a dishonest man. It says nothing about his gaining that money with being dishonest. So I believe he was an honest man. The Bible never described that he obtained his riches by bad means. Matter of fact, the problem is, he just invested his life in the things of the world instead of the things of Christ. Now don't get me wrong. We all have to work somewhere. The mayor has a great responsibility to help this city grow and prosper. That's your job. And we praise the Lord for that. Thank you so much for that. But what's more important that your job is that you serve Christ first. When you serve Christ first, those things that you have to do on the job come so much better. God blesses so much more than if you did it without Christ. It's my personal belief that this rich man was not a bad man. Matter of fact, on the contrary, I see this rich man being a compassionate man. I would go as far as to say that he was concerned about the poor man Lazarus. I think he had concern about him. In verse number 20, it says, Lazarus was at the gate. Not inside the gate, not inside the house, He wasn't kneeling on the floor at the dinner table, hoping the rich man would spill some crumbs on the floor. Look at verse 20. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gates full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. I believe the rich man told his servants to make sure you send out the crumbs or what was left to take them to Lazarus. He was concerned. He had compassion. He was not a bad guy, but the Bible says even though he was a good man, a rich man, he had compassion for people. When he died, he went to hell. It doesn't matter how good you are. It matters what your relationship is with Jesus Christ. I'm not bragging what I'm about to tell you, but I'm trying to get you to see something this morning. My plane ticket to come here, and I don't fly first class. I can't afford that. Agile won't pay my way. I don't have good friends here. I'm joking. I paid $4,000 to fly here. I paid $1,000 to bring the vests here. He didn't pay for them. I paid for them. So, and here's why. Not a good friend. I'm looking for a better friend. I like you better. But I do that because in law enforcement, young men, see what that patch says right there? You know what that says to me in America? Rookies. Do they know what that means? Rookie cop. It's because we have a brotherhood. You don't know me, but I'm your brother in law enforcement. And I care that you stay safe. So I bring bulletproof vests to give you. I don't charge anybody anything. I just give the vest to you. Right? And I go and preach the gospel. And I've had, in doing my ministry, it's called, where's my cards? Did they get them? Who's got them? Roy, bring me a bunch. You only brought me one? Thank you. All right, go get me that big box. Bring me the box. The whole box. This is my ministry, Signal 63. All right? These are just several of the different countries. You can't see it from there. Places I go. And I preach the gospel. And we've had 656 police officers accept Christ just doing this. All over. Now listen. That's not a pat on the back for me. But if you were to see this, just see that I do this, you would say, ha. That's a good man there. That's a good man for doing that. But if I died doing this ministry without Christ, all those good deeds mean zero to me because I don't get to go to heaven. I don't get to go to heaven and rejoice. Both of my parents are in heaven this morning. I'm going to have a great reunion day one day, amen. I'm going to go see Moses. Amen. I'm going to go see the Apostle Paul. Amen. And number one, I'm going to get to go see my Savior, Jesus Christ. Not because I'm a good guy. Because I'm not. I'm a sinner saved by grace. So this rich man, he wasn't a bad guy. He was concerned. He wanted to help. He just invested in buildings and properties and business and trading of stock. More than he invested in the Word of God and other people. And the Bible says in Luke chapter 16, verse 23, listen, And in hell, he lifted up his eyes, being in torments. Torments. I've been hurt before. I've been shot doing my work as a policeman right here. Got shot right here. Put a hole in my side. I was arresting a guy, and I got shot. It didn't hurt too bad. Really, it didn't. Your body has a way of not hurting. It hurt later, but it didn't hurt the day I got shot. It hurt, though. That's not torment. That's just pain. The Bible says if you go to hell, you're going to lift up your eyes in torments. The rich man was cast into hell. Lazarus was carried into paradise. The rich man was tormented while Lazarus was comforted. The rich man lived with demons while Lazarus was in fellowship with Abraham and God. You need to understand something this morning. When you die without Jesus Christ, there is no getting out. There are religions today that I know what they study. I've been in the ministry now for 25 years, full-time ministry. And there are other religions out there that teach that when you go to hell, if you have family members who loved you, and after you die, we can go to the church and we can pay money and we can pray and we can pull them out of their waiting place. My challenge to you this morning, come show me where it says that in the Bible. Come show me. It is not there. I've read this Bible 20 times through, from the front to the end, just as my regular reading. I've read it at least 20 times, front to back, back to front, chronological order. I've read it every way you could imagine. There has never, ever been in the scripture that I read where someone can pay your way out of hell except for Jesus Christ, who paid the price and died on the cross and rose again and defeated death and gave us victory so we can go to heaven. But to get that benefit, you have to trust the person that provided that gift. Jesus Christ. You may be sitting there and say, man, you say Jesus Christ an awful lot. Yes, I do, because he's my Savior. And because of that, I get to go to heaven. Because of that, my wife gets to go to heaven. Because of that, my son goes to heaven. Because of that, my daughter goes to heaven. Because of that, my other daughter goes to heaven. Because of that, my father went to heaven. Because of that, my mother went to heaven. Do you understand why I say Jesus Christ? Because he provided a gift.
Amen.
And that gift is still present today.
Amen.
Still present today. All right, I'm as we say in America, I'm about to land this plane.